Ah, yes, the homecoming. Vacation is over. The Obamas have returned to Andrews Air Force Base and now have arrived back at the White House, and the president has an extraordinarily full plate waiting for him.
It's almost like maybe a thing changed, one or two things changed, little things perhaps, since he left Washington a couple weeks ago. Top Line starts right now.
Hello and welcome to ABCNews.com's Top Line. I'm David Chalian.
And I'm Rick Klein.
Happy New Year to everyone. We're here every weekday bringing you the very latest political headlines, reporting, insight, analysis, everything you need and want to know about politics.
And it's twitter.com/thenote to be part of the conversation. It works just as well in 2010 as it did in 2009.
Maybe even a little bit better. Kick this decade of Top Line off, sir.
Indeed. The next war? Yemen is center stage right now as there are closed embassies and lots of scrambles on the security front back here, and a much different political agenda for President Obama and Democrats. They are returning to such a different situation than the one they left just a few weeks ago when we were talking about health care. Now we're talking about terrorism, we're talking about Yemen, and it is just everything seems to have changed as a result of this foiled Christmas Day plot.
Well, certainly in today's world of minute-by-minute news cycles, it does change on a dime, and something like this, a big story, can consume a lot of the oxygen. But I think with the healthcare still out there, State of the Union upcoming, you'll see if there's no more terrorism out there to report on, you'll see a return to some sense of normal. No huddle offense. That is what Jonathan Cohn, one of the best healthcare reporters in town, is reporting on TNR.com, The New Republic. Rick, he is saying that there is not going to be a formal conference committee. Now, we had talked about this as a possibility before we left for break and Congress left for town, that there may not be a formal conference committee, that staff, members of Congress from both houses of the Senate will work this out behind closed doors, but they want to hurry this along so that the president can sign health care reform, and also, I think, to make sure that none of the 60 Democrats that were with him slip away.
Right. This is probably a little more intellectually honest, actually, to say we're not going to have a conference committee, because let's face it, this was going to be figured out by a couple of key members of leadership anyway. This takes away some of the procedural obstacles that would have allowed Republicans maybe to hold it up, but it's still, you have to watch carefully what happens in the process, because keep in mind, there are a lot of folks who are still unhappy with what the final product is going to be, and they want to make sure their voices are heard. So anything that says, even to Democrats, this isn't a full negotiation and a full discussion, that's problematic.
Watch for Ben Nelson's reaction to this news if there's no conference committee. If he's not happy with no full conference committee, I would imagine we're going to have a full conference committee.
I like that. Good prediction for 2010. I like it. Missing link? That's the question for Rhode Island voters now. As former Senator Lincoln Chafee, the former Republican who lost the seat in 2006, is launching an independent bid for governor of Rhode Island, the Ocean State. Senator Chafee, if he had run for re-election as an independent, a lot of folks think he would still be a senator right now. It's an interesting test case, though, because here is someone with a good brand name in Rhode Island challenging the political establishment and running as an independent in a state that has a pretty large number of independents. It's always hard to run and win as an indie, but I think Lincoln Chafee, you got to give him a good shot.
An indie with name ID that actually fits the state and perhaps a majority of the state, he's certainly a real threat. And finally today, the Romney return. Yes, it is that time again for all those presidential aspirants to be pushing their new books. We talked to Mike Huckabee about his not too long ago. Mitt Romney is now launching his book tour this March. He will be in Iowa. Obviously, the expectations game of the crowd that gets drawn for Huckabee versus Palin versus Romney on the Iowa bookstore trail will certainly be sort of in focus for the Iowa reporters.
And Romney aide saying off the bat, well, you know, Sarah Palin is just a different communicator than Mitt Romney, so don't expect the same crowds.
Different communicator.
Necessarily.
We're going to begin with all of the news of the day. We're joined by Jane Hampshire, FireDogLake.com. Thank you very much for being here. I want to begin with this news that is dominating right now the president's attention and agenda and all of his aides. You may have seen his counterterrorism czar, John Brennan, on the Sunday shows yesterday talking through this. And in fact, the president is today, came back a little bit early, going to meet with the CIA, going to meet with Brennan today to sort of get a jump start on his big terror Homeland Security Council meeting that he's called for tomorrow. I want you to take a listen to what the 9/11 Commission co-chair, Tom Kaine of New Jersey, the former Republican governor of New Jersey, what he said on CNN's State of the Union yesterday. Take a listen.
Well, the president now is saying the right things, and I believe he'll follow through and do the right things. The problem was not now, but the fact before that this administration, I think, was distracted.
Is that true, Jane? Do you think that this administration was distracted from from terrorism because of the big push on the economy, healthcare, and other big agenda items?
Absolutely not. I think that they were focusing on it. I think it's always been very important to them. I think what we're seeing is more, demagoguery of the terror message by Republicans. That's the game plan that they've been, working from for a long time. And I frankly hope that they keep it up into 2010, because I don't think that's where the country is. I think I would much rather run against the Republicans on that than on financial scandal, or banking stuff, because we've got the country at 10% unemployment. That's where people's hearts are going to be.
So what's the response from liberals, from Democrats, if you hear people like Governor Kaine saying that? What do you say back?
I don't even think the Republicans are there at that point. You're seeing candidates like Rand Paul, who very may well win in Kentucky. You've got Adam Kokesh running in Arizona. They're running as anti-war candidates. This terror, terror, terror message is threatening to change the American character into sort of this defensive crouch of, permanent, aggression. And the country is just not there. And I think that the Republicans are finding it out within their own party, too, that this is just not the messaging that people are responding to.
One of the big political agenda items and policy agenda items for President Obama is to close down Guantanamo, the prison camp in Guantanamo. He had hoped to do that within a year of his taking office. Obviously, that deadline is going to be blown. But knowing that some of these al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, who helped this Nigerian man prepare for this, were released from Guantanamo, sent back to Yemen, back onto the battlefield, does this not open up a very legitimate question of whether shutting down Guantanamo right now, as quickly as the Obama administration hopes to do so, is the right policy?
Well, they're not letting everybody go. they are, when you're talking about specifically, about Thompson in Illinois, you've got people there, again, if you're balancing jobs against terror, the idea that these people are more dangerous than anybody we've ever faced in the history of the nation is a bit far-fetched, and we've managed to put them all through our judicial system before. So you've got the people in Thompson saying, we want them to be housed here. We want the jobs. We want to be able to do that, and we feel like we have confidence in our system that we can do that. So, you're going to be straining against that kind of messaging increasingly, and I think that that's the one that people are going to be responding to.
Jane, let's switch gears and talk healthcare. What do you make of this, the apparent strategy that would bypass a conference committee? Does that make a difference in your mind?
Well, they're basically saying that the House of Lords is going to get to dictate much of what the bill is, because as we know, as you mentioned, President Nelson has decreed what can and can't be in the bill, and Mary Landrieu has told everybody that she won't accept any changes. So they're probably going to try and negotiate back channel with the House and then push something out there. The deals would have been, as you said, between leadership anyway. But it does dispense with the process of assigning conferees and having people with, other votes at least have a say in the process. So the idea that Harry Reid has his hands tied by Republicans is ridiculous. He's the Senate Majority Leader. He could get this through. They've got this deadline for themselves of the State of the Union address. But they've already declared that they're not going to address anything else substantive this year anyway. So I don't know why this is a big deadline. This political, health care is not a political, should not be a political victory.
You said that Harry Reid, that it's ridiculous to think that his hands are tied by Republicans, but you joked about President Nelson. His hands are tied by the centrist Democrats to get
healthcare. He's letting his hands be tied by the centrist Democrats. Remember when Mitch McConnell was majority leader and he'd threaten people's chairmanships and, do all kinds of procedural stuff and make people stay there during holidays in order to get things through? Harry Reid hasn't tried any of those things. And what Ben Nelson is insisting on is very close to what the deals that the White House negotiated were during the summer. So I have a hard time believing that he's really straining against this 60-vote thing.
Jane Hampshire of FireDogLake.com, thank you very much for being here today. We appreciate it. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.